The following is an unedited conversation with poet and literary activist E. Ethelbert Miller. He joins me from Washington, D.C. as we talk about his poem, If My Blackness Turns to Fruit, a poem which I set to music and appears on the album Fearfully and Wonderfully Made with Richard Kelly. Always going beyond the surface and beyond the poem, Ethelbert talks baseball and the blues. He talks about lynching and incarceration. He speaks of the Civil War, Reconstruction, and in modern times, Roe v. Wade. On this latter subject, we can both agree that the battle for the soul of America is very much at stake. But ultimately, Miller presents a vision for America that is one of love and of hope. I hope you enjoy the musical clip, and I hope you enjoy the conversation that follows. Thank you. Ethelbert, once again, great to see you and hear from you. And we're here today. I'm talking with Ethelbert Miller, incredible poet. And we've collaborated on a few pieces over the years, very different. And what brings us together here, we want to talk about one of our collaborations, Ethelbert's amazing poem, If My Blackness Turns to Fruit. And right now, it's on the CD. I wrote some music for this. You probably can't see it too well, a little glare. Fearfully and Wonderfully Made. Richard Kelly, trumpet player, amazing trumpet player, sings on it. I'm playing piano. The funny thing is most of the CD is classical and it's organ and trumpet. And this is a change of genre. It's on the outside, it's a jazz piece, but there's so much to the poem. I loved the poem. It was such an honor and privilege.
Well, you know, you created what we would call like Duke Ellington's sacred music, you know.
Yeah, it's a real honor.
There's a connection between the sacred and the jazz thing.
Oh yeah, definitely. And we thought, you know, the message was consistent with the rest of the message. We did one of the pieces is Fearfully and Wonderfully Made, and this is a print publication on that of a four movement suite for organ and trumpet. You know, classical piece. And then we did some stuff by Dan Pinkham, also sacred music based on scripture, but impressions of this. So Rich Kelly doesn't sing on any of it till the end.
Right. We've gotten way ahead of ourselves, man, but I got to introduce Ethelbert Miller is, I had the privilege of, I met you in 2016. We were working on a project with the Seraphim Singers. You wrote a poem back in the 90s called I Am the Land in honor of Oscar Romero. And then I wrote some music on it. It's a completely different style, but let me give you a little background on Ethelbert. Those of you who are not familiar with him and who he is. I've got some of his bio. There's a lot here. He's done a lot. So we're going to check this out. E. Ethelbert Miller is a writer and literary activist. He is the author of two memoirs and several books of poetry, including The Collected Poems of E. Ethelbert Miller, a comprehensive collection that represents over 40 years of his work. Miller's poetry has been translated into nearly a dozen languages. For 17 years, he served as the editor of Poet Lore, the oldest poetry magazine published in the United States. Miller is a two-time Fulbright Senior Specialist Program Fellow to Israel. He holds an honorary degree of Doctor of Literature from Emory and Henry College and has taught at several universities. There's a whole lot more, a couple of more cool things we gotta talk about that you've done. You're the host of the weekly WPFW morning radio show On the Margin with E. Ethelbert Miller, and the host and producer of The Scholars on UDC-TV, which received a 2020 Telly Award. In recent years, you were inducted into the 2015 Washington, D.C. Hall of Fame and awarded the 2016 AWP George Garrett Award for Outstanding Community Service in Literature and the 2016 D.C. Mayor's Award for Distinguished Honor. Goes on, man. You've got a lot more beautiful things. Most recently, a grant from the D.C. Commission on the Arts and Humanities, a congressional award from Congressman Jamie Raskin in recognition of your literary activism. There's a lot more. You've also got several books out. You won the literary award for poetry by the Black Caucus of the American Library Association for your book, If God Invented Baseball. That's a great book. Read it all. I don't have a copy. I gave it away, all my copies. Oh, okay.
Well, you know, well, it's two other. I should send you. You know, I just finished the.
Oh, I got them.
The trilogy.
I got them, man. You know, okay. This is how I found love behind the catcher's mask, and I got them, and I got this one.
Here you go. Okay, you got the whole set.
I'm good. No, but I need you. We need to get together, so I need you to sign these.
Okay, sure.
We got to sign them. So,
all right.
So, you know. I'd love to know when you wrote the poem and how it came to light. As far as the public know, as far as I know, you were a guest on NPR's Morning Edition in 2019. And it was a show about the bicentennial of Walt Whitman. And you read the poem shortly after that show. You approached me to write some music for it. But what's the genesis of that entire
situation? You know, it's not the Whitman connection.
Yeah.
There was a woman from Chicago who was doing some experimental stuff here in Washington a number of years ago, and she asked me to write a poem. That's when I wrote the poem, you know. Yeah. She wanted something that was political and uplifting, and so that's what I had. And I think when the Whitman celebration came along, I decided that, okay, this would be an appropriate poem to read. So it got a much wider audience from the NPR, but it was a poem that I didn't write it in terms of celebrating, you know, Walt Whitman.
Sure, yeah. I think what was fascinating about it is a vision of America.
Right.
And I'm so curious about, it is uplifting. And you have mentioned it's been compared to the song made famous by Billie Holiday, Strange Fruit, but mm-hmm. it's such a different era. And it to me, it almost sounds like a wise elder mm-hmm. with an internal love. But I think we're going to have to hear the poem.
I'll read the poem. And then because you invited me, I made some notes. So I'll share that with you. And then you might want to give me some feedback, because by inviting me to talk to you today, I went back and looked at the poem critically.
Yeah.
Okay. So some of the things that I'm putting together to tell you is probably the first time I pulled it together and thought about the poem. You know, you write the poem, mm. you don't necessarily think about it.
Yeah.
I'll read it, and then I'll share my notes with you.
Wonderful.
If my blackness turns to fruit. Dear America, my love. If my blackness turns to fruit, do not pull it from the vine. Let it grow from earth to sky, untouched by hateful hands. So sweet my juice, my jazz, my blues, so sad but true. Dear America, my love, look behind your prison walls. Count the black seas behind bars, the cells where nothing blooms. Can hope flower from despair? Yes, America, my love. Resistance comes, and then the rain. You know, so let me share about that. First of all, it's very important that this poem be recognized that it's a sonnet. You know, when we think of love poems and sonnets, it goes together. So this is a sonnet. You can see that what I've done is I've used a sort of like a letter format that I'm addressing America, the same way you would address a lover who, you know, you're writing to. So it's Dear America. And the America that I'm writing to, you know, if I was going steady with America or engaged, I want to go out with the America after the Civil War. The America during Reconstruction. And what I've been telling people, especially because of what's happening today in terms of our Supreme Court, is that there are two constitutions. There's the Constitution of the Founding Fathers, and then there's the second constitution that takes place after the Civil War, which has all the friendly amendments. and that's when the country is sort of like rebooting, we use that terminology, but it's being reborn. And what happens, if you look at the interpretation of the Constitution, and this gets into when Thurgood Marshall was on the court. We can look at the Constitution as being elastic, okay? That everything is not this strict interpretation of the Constitution in terms of the founding fathers were not dealing with homosexuality, women's rights, and things of that sort. But what happened, these amendments that start dealing with giving blacks a right to vote, you know, and citizenship, that's when we begin to see our Constitution expanding. So if, for example, we now say, okay, how do we handle the rights of people who have disabilities? Well, we look to that second constitution. We also realize that one of the great experiments of Reconstruction was the fact that, you know, you look at so many things begin with Reconstruction, public education, you know, not just for the newly emancipated slave, but for everyone. Okay, you begin to see, you know, democracy, you know, really being born, and so in this sense, this letter, you know, that this Dear America, that's who I'm addressing it to, you know, in terms of that person. But then we think of what you mentioned. Some people think of Strange Fruit because it's, if my blackness turns to fruit, and so what happens? We think of the composition that Billie Holiday sang, which was actually composed by April Mirapol.
Right.
And so it's a 1930. And if you go back to that period, you know that lynchings were very prominent. That's what was happening. And that song, I think, really captured what was going on. My poem, If My Blackness Turns to Fruit, is not about lynching, but instead about incarceration. Okay. Now, someone could say that's the new form of lynching. Okay. But what happens is that it's very important to look at the historical periods. Strange Fruit is a 1930, you know, composition. Mine is one that's current. Then you see what's very important, the cultural reference in terms of music. If we look at what might be the essence of blackness, if we look at structure, especially, we know that the blues has a structure. We also know that the blues is distinctly African-American. You know, this is something that I think Leroy Jones, Mary Baraka writes about in his book, Blues People. You know, as soon as that African, you know, is here in the field and looks up and realizes he's not going back to Africa, you know, the blues comes in because what have you got to make sense out of this. And one could say this, there's no blues unless there's a middle passage. There's no blues unless there's slavery. OK, and then what happens is that the blues, and this is where I have the connection to, there's no jazz without the blues. And but at the same time, this music, this blues is the essence of blackness. So that's why somebody said, well, are you black or are you blue? Or you're black and blue. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the essence of blackness is the blues. And the blues has a structure. See? So that's why it's very important that you can teach it. Okay, you can teach the blues because it has a structure. But then somebody will come along and say, you're singing the blues, but you don't feel the blues.
Right. That's right.
Okay. And so what happens is that when we talk about, you know, somebody can walk around, you know, thinking they black, you know, but what happens is that, you know, there's something that's missing. The same way sometimes, you know, somebody will see a very fair-skinned African-American, you know, man or woman. Somebody say, no, that person's black. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? You know, they may not say it, but, yeah. you know, maybe they're Italian or something like that. But there's something happening there by the way the person walks, or just something that you that is conveyed yeah. that you can pick up intuitively, that, you know, there's something that you connect with. And that's what I wanted to do in terms of making these references to blues and jazz and deal with the bitterness and the sweet, because the blues is not just sadness; it's also joy, joyful, and the blues is also resilience. And so there's some way that you can celebrate the blues in a joyful manner. Now, what's really key about the poem, and this has a lot to do with the sonnet. Usually, in a sonnet, you have what's called a volto or a turn, which occurs in the ninth line. Okay, if you look at my poem, that's the ninth, the second stanza deals with the lost potential of promise of black
that's right,
lives.
That's right.
That's
right.
The turn in the poem. Okay, and that's where I'm looking at black youth being destroyed by becoming part of the criminal justice system. I'm looking at what happens to once you are incarcerated, where you look at your education is disrupted, your employment. You if you come out of being incarcerated, you check that box, you can't get work. You know, you can't, you know, get the right to vote. So all those things, you see this twist right there, this turn in the poem into the second stanza. Now, if you look at the poem, there's only one question being asked in this poem. And that's that right. is the question, can hope flower from despair?
That's
the only line that you see a question mark after. And you could circle that word despair, because that word captures our society's helplessness. Okay. Now, gotta get to the end. The final line echoes this other sonnet by Claude McKay that was written during the 1990 in the race riots, "If We Must Die," which is, I call that a sonnet of resistance. And so what happens is that if you connect the two, where I say, "Yes, America, my love," resistance comes, and then the rain. The two lines are actually that. "Yes, America, my love." Resistance comes, and then the rain. That's actually one sentence.
That's right. Yeah.
But because I'm dealing with a sonnet form, I have to break it into two, so it's 14. Okay.
Yeah,
so, but it's just one line. Now, this is where, you know, you look at your composition. How you read this last line, okay, has a lot to do with your politics, okay? Where what happens is that if you put an emphasis on the word resistance or rain, that's where it is, okay? The resistance is a more militant term. The rain has more of like a baptismal tone and underscores the need for the fruit to be nourished and protection. But either way, the poem is composed to be uplifting. The same way, if you go back to Claude McKay, "If We Must Die," I believe during that 1919, the riots, I think McKay might have been like a Pullman porter. So what happens, many of the riots were breaking out in cities. Sometime a train's coming, you don't know what's going on. You could be grabbed off that train by a mob, okay? But what happens, you see that defines, you know, about fighting back, you know? So that poem, as people say historically, Winston Churchill used that during World War II to sort of rally England, you know, it's fine, we will resist, we will fight, we're back, our backs are against the wall, we're fighting back. Yeah, and that is very important if, for example, I wanted to read this poem that way, but then I could also end it, make it very gentle, and then the rain, which is a cleansing rain. I think of some John Coltrane compositions like Central Park, you know, where you just get a sense of like you go out after a storm and the air is clean and fresh, you know, things begin to grow, you know.
Yeah.
You know? And what happens, you realize that that's the type of air you want to inhale, that what happens, sometimes you have to see that cleaning of the streets. You know, you have to see that washing away. This is why if you're a very biblical person, you say, oh, yes, there has to be a Noah, you know, because a Noah, you know, Noah knew how to clean things up. You know, you've got to have a flood, you know, you got to have that, because what happens is that, you know, it is a way of transition. And also what happens, that's where the hope is. You know, if you look at around the world with climate change, where there's droughts, okay, and there is no rain, and getting back to the question about the helplessness, yeah, what happens? We need the rain. You know, we need to realize that not only is the rain, but we have to realize that, this maybe shows my age, I remember when the rain was dangerous. And the rain was dangerous during the time of nuclear testing, when it was like strontium 90, where what happened, we were testing bombs above ground, the mushroom cloud would float over, you know, from the Micronesia to upstate New York. And then if it rained, the rain had the strontium 90 that all of a sudden fell into the grass, the cows would eat the grass, and all of a sudden your milk. You know, milk has been
everything's connected. We're all connected.
Everything's connected. Yeah. So this poem is in a short way. You know, I just sort of outlined some of the things in terms of how it's put together and what I was thinking. But you know, in terms of all poetry, it's up to the interpretation, and that's why when we collaborate, it's always refreshing to me and educational to me in terms of how you're going to interpret it. You know, what are you going to place the emphasis on?
Yeah. It was interesting. We talked about resistance a little bit. We had an early draft in July of 2019. And you had asked me, I think it needs more emphasis on resistance.
Mm-hmm.
And I went back and we did just that, hopefully. You know, and because I understand how important that's a like a turning point. The word resistance, the rain, the transition doesn't happen without the resistance.
And you can see today how problematic that word is, especially coming after January 6th, because many people feel, depending on the political politics, we're resisting. You know, so that word is being wrestled by two different political sides. You know, people seriously think that, you know, I'm resisting what they feel is this movement towards, you know, a particular society they don't like in terms of their values and things of that sort. So you have this struggle and this battle, but this is why it goes back. I go back to, you know, this country still wrestling with the Civil War. Okay. And this is why I tell people, if you look at recently what happened around Roe versus Wade, what the voting in Kansas, I tell people, yeah, Kansas, it sounds like, you know, the women went to the polls the way John Brown went into Kansas with his sons, you know what I mean? You know, with the bleeding Kansas, it's like, yeah, all of a sudden the battle over the soul of America takes place right there in Kansas. Okay. And I think that what might happen, and we might see this next week, you might go back, because the pundits are always wrong. And let me tell you why the pundits are always wrong. You held up my books in the beginning. Did any of the pundits think there was going to be a no-hitter yesterday? No.
No, man. Who thought that was going to happen? Hey, it's possible, man. That happens.
That was coming, right? Okay. Yeah. So, okay. So you figure this, right? And this is the Houston Astros, right? So I'm saying next week, maybe Beto wins Texas. And there's a blue wave, and somebody said, we didn't see that coming.
Anything, you know,
I mean, no, you don't look at this. Look, you deal with the Houston Astros, right? There are people in Brazil who Lula's back.
Yeah.
There are people in Israel saying Netanyahu's back.
Yeah.
Yeah, nobody predicted that.
No.
You see? And that's how you have to approach, you know, the society, because we have to have that same hope that Walt Whitman had when he was taking care of the soldiers, like here in Washington, and where he knows that the country, because what are we talking about? If we look beyond Kansas, okay, we're saying after the Civil War, the country expands west, and the whole West represents a certain degree of freedom. This is why, if you teach American history, you can't tell somebody to wear a mask in Wyoming or Montana,
yeah,
you know, or like Governor Abbott tells you, yeah, you guys are part of the United States, but we're Texas. And I say that because it comes back to this poem. If I say, dear America, I want to embrace all 50 states. Okay, I want to embrace all 50 states. Now, that may exclude Sarah Palin and where Obama was born. but you see what I'm saying?
They're there because
some people only accept certain countries, as, you know, certain states as being the United States.
Right.
You see, I jokingly say in terms of just addressing Dear America, it is one of love and also hope.
Yeah, that really struck me immediately. There is so much to say about this poem. From my end, I think I had the great privilege of spending a lot of time with it. I don't know how long it took you to write it and how then you move on to your other projects. You're very prolific. But, you know, in terms of the music, I spent a lot of time with your words on three different pieces. And constantly combing through, writing, rewriting, and then bounce some things off of you and then some revision there. And then some time went by and, you know, then kind of had a new vision as to how we should record the piece. And then, it's been a few years since it came about with this, but I've had a lot of time to think about this. And, you know, while it's jazz on the outside, the piece is also in a way kind of a classical art song. You have Dear America, you address America three times.
Mm-hmm.
And the three is a perfect symmetry on this. And it happens at each turning point. The beginning, right in the middle, before that ninth line.
Mm-hmm.
And then answers the question.
Right.
And I have it in three different keys. Starts out in F. Mm-hmm. Then it goes down a step before that turning point about incarceration. Look beyond the prison walls. Count the black seeds.
Mm-hmm.
Which is pretty, pretty intense. Then asking the question, can hope flower in despair? Mm-hmm. Now, the despair chord is an open fifth. There's no color, there's no major, there's no minor. It's not happy, it's not sad, it's just open despair. Yes, you answer the question, yes. Now it's in an elevated key.
Right.
And the listener may or may not detect these because they're subtle changes.
But you connect as a composer.
But that was just trying to color the words and paint an experience. And kind of blew my mind. When I first read it, I first was really deeply taken in about, I'd never seen a poem like this, you know, in the way that you address America. And then in the way that you offer solution viewpoint and imperative, this is what has to happen.
Well, you know, when you say that, you echo the work of another writer who's influenced by Whitman, and that's Langston Hughes.
Mm.
You know, Let America Be America Again. There's just poems in which Langston, in terms of the period of time that he comes through, he and I always tell people that Langston is the witness to the Great Migration, you know, of Black going from the South to the North. You know, he sees that when he's in high school in Cleveland, and listening to the Southern migrants who are moving north, and so what happens is that people leave the South, you know, escaping the violence of the Klan, stuff like that, but they leave also for hope, economic improvement, you know, all those things that, you know, the North represents is sort of paradise. And what's sad is that sometimes, you know, you get into the Harlems and the Chicagos, and all of a sudden it's not a paradise. You're in a kitchenette apartment, you know. And this is where, in terms of the music, this is where the music, we get the urban blues, you know. And that's the thing where you see the evolution and development of the transformation of African-American music, you know, and as African-American life is changed.
I can't tell you what a great honor this was to just to spend, you know, just spend time with your words and to, you know, because for me, you know, this is not my experience, you know, but we're all united. We're all connected. The more we elevate each other, we're all elevated. We have to uplift each other. And I hope, you know, I can help with a small way in that. We're gonna have the world premiere of that right here. I'm sitting here. This is the Cathedral of the Holy Cross, and Rich Kelly and I are gonna have We're going to do a CD release concert for the CD Fearfully and Wonderfully Made.
You sent me the press material.
I owe you a hard copy of that too. You know, it's available. This is available for download. You know, iTunes, Amazon, everywhere, right. And also you can look at the. I'll include the website for anyone can look at that. You can either get the song itself or the whole CD. But it's sort of the capstone of the entire piece. You know, we thought we had 10 pieces. We're like, do we want to add this one on? It doesn't fit
into a little coda, though.
On the outside, it doesn't, right. But the message really does. Sure. And well, I'm so grateful to you for being, you're so generous.
You've complimented, you know, a writer can only hope when you just say the amount of time that you spent with something that I wrote. That's the highest compliment. The same
and I loved it. Yeah. And I loved spending that time. I loved it.
And that's how we grow. Yeah. That's how as artists, and that's how we grow as human beings.
Yeah. Yeah. Because I know every not just say every word, but every phrase, every interpretation is something that has been a lot of time and a lot of your soul was put into that. And then therefore, you know, it's like a sacred trust to have that trust to me. I'd like, you know, someone to go out and interpret that. And there's some, that could go a lot of different ways,
you know,
and that could come in a way that you'd be like, it's not really, you know, that really isn't where I wanted to go with it. Right. Or maybe it is. And then how the performer does it. And Richard Kelly, he's an amazing trumpet player, plays with the Boston Pops. He's played with the Boston Symphony. He teaches at Boston Conservatory, Berklee College of Music. But the thing is, he's a beautiful human being. Mm-hmm. His soul is incredible. It comes out in his sound, in his trumpet. I say he doesn't play the trumpet. I say that's his muse that he plays, you know, and he's been singing more and he plays and sings and you can see it. You hear the soul. So we're very, very blessed to have him and to sort of have this come together. We're looking forward to it. We're going to end the concert with this and hopefully blow some minds because people are going to see us. We're going to play the organ. We're going to do all this bunch of classical guys and say, hang on 1 second. We got to crank up. We're going to check out the piano.
You know, when you say that, you know, songs and music, you know, sort of changes during the times, you know, there could be a song that all of a sudden, I always felt, for example, that if Lean On Me had come out a little earlier, it might have replaced We Shall Overcome. You know, it just had this thing, Lean On Me, you know what I mean? You know, the same way if you listen to Lift Every Voice and Sing, to me, the only person that really sings that song, the way I like it, is Ray Charles. You know, he brings that up.
There's nothing better than Ray Charles.
Right,
you know? I mean, we sing that here. We sing that here from time to time, but there's nothing as good as Ray Charles. You know, you can't compare yourself. That's great, man.
Right.
Which is pretty amazing. So anyway, I think we're going to have to wrap this up because they're going to shut us down. I could talk to you all day about your poems because there's, you know, I just opened up something from here. It's something, it was a poem about Roberto Clemente.
It's the last poem.
Immediately just blew my mind. You know, there was another one that I ran across that was in, I think it was in the Times, New York Times magazine.
That was the one. Emmett Till.
Emmett Till is where how it ends. You start talking about a Yankee Stadium, and you're talking about running like you're Emmett Till, like.
Right.
Mind blown. You know, you have this beautiful way of having a relatively small amount of words say an enormous amount.
That's like what we call like the economy of words, you know, and when I started out writing, you know, back in 68, 69, you know, I always wrote very short poems. But, you know, I feel now going back, you know, I'm working on haiku, you know, it's sort of, you know, compressing things down and realizing that, you know, even a dash or a punctuation carries a lot of weight.
It's just amazing. It's also like, you know, many of the African-American spirituals, you know, we're looking at sheet music. I'm like, listen, they were not singing this with sheet music. That was not happening. Very few words right. an extraordinary depth of meaning that even I could never mm-hmm. understand, but they are such a gift, continuing gift to all of us. Yeah. Listen, we're going to have to wrap this up.
Thank
Listen,
you very much.
So
well, send me a link to this
and I'll
you know, share, because it's very educational.
It's been wonderful. This is an amazing conversation. We got to do this more often.
Okay. Give my regards to everybody there.
I will, and you too. You too, absolutely.
All right, many blessings. Okay.
Look behind your prison walls, count the black seas.